Simon & Schuster Audio presents My Heart is a Chainsaw by Stephen Graham Jones. Read by Cara Gee.
To Deborah Hill, thank you from all of us. The slasher film lies by and large beyond the purview of the respectable. Carol J. Clover. Night School. On the battered paper map that's carried the two of them across, they're not sure how many of the American states now. This is Proof Rock, Idaho, and the dark body of water before them is Indian Lake, and it kind of goes forever out into the night. Does that mean there's Indians in the lake? Or does it mean that Indians made it? Lot asks, a gleam of excitement to her eyes. Everything here is named after Indians, Sven says back, whispering because there's something solemn about being awake when everyone's asleep. Their rental car is ticking down behind them from the six-hour push from Casper. The doors open because they just wanted to look, to see, to soak all this in before going back to the Netherlands at the end of the week. Lot shines her phone's light down onto the fluttering map and looks up from it and across the water, like trying to connect what she's seeing in lines and grids to what she's actually standing in. Vot, Sven says. In American, Lot tells him for the 200th time. If they want partial course credit for immersion, they have to actually immerse. What? Sven repeats, the word belligerent in English, like trying to make elbow room for itself. That should be the national forest on the other side, Lot says, chinning across the water because her hands are struggling to get the map shut. Everything's a national forest, Sven grumbles, angling his head as if to peer deeper into the darkness at all these black trees. But you can't do that in the King's Forest, can you? Lot asks, finally getting the map folded in one of the six different ways it's possible to fold it. Sven follows her eyes across Indian Lake. There's little floating pinpoints of light over there that only really come into focus when you look into the darkness right beside them. Huh, he says, Lotte coming up behind him to rest her chin on his shoulder, hold his waist in her hands. Sven breathes in deep with wonder when the lights rearrange themselves, suggesting great yellow necks in the inky blackness, strange and massive animals piecing the world together one lakeshore at a time. Then, a ways down the shore, a ball of flickering light arcs up into the velvety sky and hangs. Hangs. Muy, Lot says right next to his ear, and Sven repeats it in American. Beautiful. We shouldn't, Lot says, which of course means the exact opposite. Sven looks back to the car, shrugs, sure, what the hell? It's not like they're going to be here again, right? It's not like they're going to get another chance to be 20 years old in America, a whole lake at their feet like it bubbled up just for them to dip their toes into, and maybe more. They leave their clothes on the hood, the antenna draped over the open doors. The mountain air is crisp and thin, their skin pale and bare. The water will be, Sven starts to say, but Lotte finishes for him. Perfect. And with that, they're running the way naked, barefoot people do across gravel, which is delicately, hugging themselves against the chill, but laughing, too, just to be doing this. Behind them, Proof Rock, Idaho is dark. Before them, a long wooden pier is reaching out over the water, pointing them across the lake. To get their nerve up for how cold this is going to be, once their feet find those wooden planks, Lotte and Sven stretch out and really run, not worried about the chance of nails or splinters or falling. Sven howls up into the vast open space all around them, and Lotte snaps a blurry picture of him with her phone. You brought that? He says, turning around to jog backwards. Document, document, she says, her arms drawn in like a boxer's now that Sven's looking back. He raises an imaginary camera, takes his own picture of her. Lotte is looking past him now, though, her eyes not as sure as they just were, her strides shortening, slowing, her hands and elbows going into strategic coverage mode. There's a much closer light flickering at what's got to be the end of the pier. and it looks for all the world like a fisherman in dark rain gear, holding an old-style lantern up at face level. No, not a fisherman. A lighthouse keeper who hasn't seen another soul for 3 years. A lighthouse keeper who thinks that holding his lantern close to his own eyes will improve his vision. And then the light's gone. Sven's hand finds Lot's, and they slow to a shuffle, the sky yawning empty and deep above them, all around them.
What?
Lot says. In American, Sven chides, forcing his smile.
I don't anymore think we should,
Lot starts, but doesn't finish because Sven, walking now instead of running, is jumping on his left foot, his right splintered or nailed or stubbed, something sudden and unpleasant. The light at the end of the pier comes on, curious.
Look,
Lot says to Sven. When he stops hopping and grabbing at the sole of his foot, the light goes back off. He nods, getting it, then stomps his hurt right foot down with authority. The light glows on.
Try it,
he says to Lot. Hesitant, she does, stomping, getting no response. But then she jumps with both feet, comes down hard enough to jangle whatever bad connection is happening down there.
Wheel lamp isn't screwed enough,
Sven diagnoses, pulling her ahead.
Screwed in enough,
Lot fixes, traipsing behind. When they get there, step into that puddle of wavering light, Sven licks the pads of his fingers and reaches up under the rusty cowl to tighten the bulb, the light losing its thready flicker immediately, shining an unwavering cone of warmth down onto their pale thighs now, their shadows stark behind them, bleeding off into the darkness.
We're gonna fix this place up right,
Sven says, meaning all of America. Lot darts in to kiss him on the cheek, then her eyes locked on Sven's the whole while, and still holding his fingertips until she can't, she steps over the end of the pier as easy as anything. Sven turns his head against the splash, smiling and cringing both. But the splash doesn't come.
Lot,
he says, stepping forward, shielding his face from the water he knows has to be coming. She's in a dark green canoe that's rocking back and forth. She must have spotted it while he was fiddling with the light bulb. Sven raises his hands, snaps another make-believe picture of her, says,
Cover up. This one's for the grandchildren's. I want them to see how amazing their Grootmoeder was when I first was knowing her.
Lot purses her lips, unable to hide her smile, and Sven steps down with her, arms wide, so as not to roll them.
This isn't stealing, he says, reaching up to unhook the canoe's rope. It was just floating here. Out there, I mean. We had to swim out even to get it, to save it.
We're gonna fix this place up,
Lot says as loud as she can, around Sven, leaning on the shaky little left-behind cooler to push them away from the pier. She trails her hands in the water and, drifting out from the pier now, can just see their rental car. It looks like a laundry bomb exploded over it. No, it looks like two kids from the Netherlands fizzed away from pure joy, disappeared into nothing, leaving only their clothes behind.
What?
Sven asks in perfect American.
We don't have a paddle,
Lot says. It's the funniest thing in the world to her. It's making this little expedition even more perfect.
Or pants, or shirts,
Sven adds, taking both sides of the canoe and rocking it back and forth.
Cowed,
Lot agrees, hugging herself. Then, like a dare.
Warmer in the water.
Out where it's deeper,
Sven says, correcting himself before she can.
Deeper.
They reach over to paddle with their hands, the water bitter cold, and after about 20 yards of this, Sven liberates the white lid off the little cooler. It's a much better paddle than their hands, and, importantly, it doesn't care about freezing.
My hero,
Lot says in precise English, pressing herself into his back. It can be warmer up here, too, Sven says, but doesn't stop drawing them farther out onto the lake. Lot presses the side of her face into his back, her new vantage point giving her an angle into the now open tiny cooler.
Hey,
she says, and extracts a clear baggie with a sandwich inside, its peanut butter smearing.
Ew, pindakos,
Sven says, and pulls deep with the cooler lid, surging them ahead. Lot unceremoniously shakes the sandwich out into the water without touching it,
crosses her finger over her lips so Sven will know not to tell on her about this, then drops her phone into the baggie and neatly seals the top, blowing into it at the very end so the phone is in a make-do balloon.
Your Ziploc tas can also be a flotati device, she says in her best KLM flight attendant voice.
Sven chuckles, says, flotation. The phone in the bag is still recording. Lotte angles it away from her, holds it up so she can see ahead of them.
What do you think they are?
Sven asks, nodding to the lights they don't seem to be any closer to yet.
Giant fireflies, Lotte says with a secret thrill.
American fireflies.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.